Are you able to see the slides? Okay, good. So, yeah, so my name is Huiying. For those of you I've met, nice to see you again. For those I haven't met before, I tend to do a lot of my work at the intersection between research and practice. So sometimes it's a bit hard to explain to people. And I think over time, I have a sense of what it means and people around me have a sense of what it means. My interest is very much in agriculture and agroecology and what it means to try to bring that more into urban settings. Anyway, in today's session, I'll share a bit about my thoughts on food security, and it's very much an opinion. So I'm very happy to have people bring in their insights and have a discussion about it afterwards. So food and well-being, we want today to think about what it means to be secure. So first, before we go any further, I want to start by considering with all of you. So if you can take like a short 30 seconds to close your eyes and start to think about something. So let's start with the image of what the perfect ideal bowl of food is for you. Let's spend a bit of time thinking, what does it look like? What's inside? What kind of colors are there? What's kind of nourishing? What does it mean to feel secure with this bowl? Maybe it's a plate, maybe it's a table. Is there a flavor that stirs your mind or stirs your taste buds? And is there a memory that comes with it? So you can keep this in your mind while we are thinking about the next few minutes as we go through our discussion today. If you are really interested to share in the chat, feel free to. We can come back to it again afterwards. So let's come back into this space with everyone else. You can open your eyes now. And I'll share what a comforting bowl of food to me is, what it means to have a secure bowl of food, or like something that makes me feel secure. So right now, this bowl of chickpeas, pumpkin, and leafy green vegetables is what makes me feel secure. There's some yogurt in it as well. And we know that food is highly cultural. So the nutrients that I need, what I want them to look like, it's very particular to me. And some people might call me selective. Some people might say I'm picky. I only eat vegetables. People's perceptions influence how I explain my choices to them. But food is also based on what you can afford. So this bowl of chickpeas could be very cheap, or it could be very costly depending on where I am, who I am. So today we're going to examine food from a few different positions. I don't know if I'll go through all seven, but I do have content for all seven, so we'll see how far we get. And the reason for this is that I feel the story of food and what it means to be secure can be told from just one perspective. So let's start with what my proposal is right from the start. And we can see how this makes sense over the next few minutes. So my proposal to everyone, my opinion, is that our sense of well-being is really linked with our environment. And that's a lot to do with the idea of where we are. So locality as where in the world are we, who are we with, what is near us, what's in our built environment, what's in the social, emotional spaces around us. And the thing is, food policy now tends to disregard locality. It tends to look at just nutrition-based kinds of measures, which is already a step ahead because nutrition wasn't even seen as something important in the past. In the past, and even now, it's still all calorie-based measures. Also, very much focused on productivity yields and the cost. So my thesis, like what I'm putting forward, is that being secure comes from where we are. It comes from an understanding of place. And perhaps when you're thinking about the bowl of food you just had in your mind, we can discuss whether, we can think about whether this makes sense or not. But I do think that locality needs to be included in food policy for people, and that's where there are some good examples in Canada and Australia, and through the FAO's city region food system approach. So long story short, we can bring our connections with land, generosity with others back into the picture through food in the form of well-being. Okay, so I'm gonna go into like different aspects of this. So the food one, the first one on food justice and access. To prepare for this talk, I was already speaking and thinking about food security for a while. But along the way, people also pointed out that, you know, sometimes thinking in terms of only food security is not helpful. And but somehow in Singapore, because of what's happening with the pandemic, people are talking about food insecurity and security. So it keeps coming back to these two terms. So I want to expand the discussion a bit. And I reached out to speak to someone about some of the food issues that like more vulnerable communities might be facing right now. And I had the chance to speak with Jing Zhou from the Kasia resettlement team last Friday. So we had a short chat and he shared some information with me that I will present now. And some of this is also based on what I was looking up on, based on the household expenditure survey. So to give an example of what food justice might mean and how it's different, it's a different perspective from, or rather it offers a different perspective to think about what it means to be secure. Singapore is one of the countries in the world where the income strata is amazingly wide. And if you look at the households here in the first to 20th quintile on the left side, and the households on the right, which are the wealthier households in the 81st to 100th quintile. So it's like separated into five in Singapore. There are orders of like 10 apart. On the left, we have households earning about an average income of $2,000. And on the right, households earn an average of $25,000. This is in per month. So it's obviously very different already. But then the spending habits they have on food is also different. So the households on the left spend about 30% of their total income on food. The households on the right spend about 6% of their total income on food. This is just in percentages. So the actual amount is something else to look at. But just in terms of proportion, of the amount that households of the low-income households spend, it's about a half-half divide between the amount that goes to groceries and the amount that goes to purchasing ready-made food. And for the households on the right, very little goes to groceries, most of it goes to ready-made food. So that already gives us some sense of what does it mean to be secure at this time if you don't have work, if you don't have money. I see someone raising a hand, so we will speak later. So I dug a bit further and I was curious about what people are spending their money on. So the difference between, if you see the differences over income, the amount that people spend on groceries, that's what I'm assuming food and non-alcoholic beverages mean, on groceries doesn't change much. It increases with income, if you look here. But then it starts to go down. Like, so the richer people get, the fewer groceries they buy. But the richer people get, the more they spend on restaurants. And it just goes all the way up. On the other hand, if you look at fruits and vegetables, there's a very stark difference as well. People in the wealthiest households spend about twice the amount on fruits as people in the lowest income spectrum. So that already says something about what people can afford. And it's sometimes difficult to keep this all in mind and understand how security means something different for everyone. So just thinking about this, for the vulnerable households, these are some of the existing groups that are trying to support families. And if we think about this also, there's different levels of access. So for instance, soup kitchens might be willing hearts. Meals on Wheels services are government-subsidized meal services. You have the supplementary providers like Free Food for All, Yummy Mummy, that are independently run for the most part, or they find their own funding. And then you have like grassroots CCC support, which also disperses meal vouchers, but they're not required to declare their how much they spend on that. So in some sense, they're harder to track. They're not transparent, unlike charities. And you have charities that provide food ration packs, meals, supermarket vouchers. And often beneficiaries say different things about, okay, vouchers are sometimes useful. They can buy things that they need. They can choose. They have choice. For people who are given a food ration pack, there isn't choice. So then there's a different approach to what it means to be secure. So, yeah, so one question is, what does it mean to be transparent? What does it mean to have information to work with so that we can make choices about where we direct our support for different organizations or businesses? But at the same time, there's often so much information out there. So how do we decide and how do we organize to get it?